Today the topic for discussion will be benign tumors of the skin, and we'll be dealing about benign soft tissue tumors first today. Before going into what these actual benign tumors are, let me give you a small introduction about, you know, what is a tumor, what is metaplasia and all that stuff. Firstly, tumor or neoplasia itself means an abnormal proliferation of your cells. Okay, there will be abnormal proliferation of any cells which is present in that local area. And this abnormal proliferation could either be similar to the cells that are present there, or they can be undifferentiated cells too. So when we are talking about a tumor, we should not get confused with the swelling, because swelling is also a growth. I mean, it is like a, because of either non-inflammatory or an inflammatory swelling can be present, and we should not get confused between a tumor and a swelling, because tumor is nothing but your abnormal proliferation. It is not a normal increase in number of cells. So to name it properly, neoplasm would be a better term to use it. Hence tumors are also called as neoplasms. And when we are talking about metaplasia is something where it is replacement of differentiated or well differentiated tissue by another form of differentiated tissue. Okay, for example, squamous metaplasia. In squamous metaplasia, where there is a we see this in chronic cholecystitis, what happens is the simple columnar cells are being replaced by squamous epithelium. That means actually structure, for example, in cholecystitis condition, where there actually it should be a simple columnar cells, but later they are replaced by squamous epithelium. It is also another well-differentiated tissue. One thing is that we are actually talking about metaplasia, where we are telling replacement of tissue and a different type of tissue in that present tissue. It can be of two types. One is physiological metaplasia and second one is pathological metaplasia. Normally, metaplasia is usually a condition where it can develop because of any irritant factor or any instigating factor or any stimulus. For example, if it has to work, or if it has to, react more to any other infections or anything, what happened? More keratinized layer is formed there as a protective mechanism. Once that irritant has been removed, it comes back to its original state of cells. Sometimes this will not come back to its original state, and then we can call it as a pathological metaplasia. Pathological metaplasias can again are of various types, and we have squamous metaplasia and columnar metaplasia. Squamous metaplasia, as we have discussed, is seen in chronic cholecystitis, and columnar metaplasia is usually seen in case of your cervical erosions, where here we have the simple epithelial layer is again replaced by your columnar cells. And we have another terminology, that is dysplasia. Dysplasia is nothing but your abnormal development of cells. Cell structure is being modified here. It can be hyperchromatism, or it can be nuclear cytoplasmic ratio can be varied here, where a normal nuclear cytoplasmic ratio is 1:4. Here what happens, it will be reversed. Your cell polarity can be reversed. There are various types of criteria, or there are various criteria to name it as a dysplasia. So dysplasia is nothing but abnormal development of a tissue or a cell. Next terminology is anaplasia. Anaplasia is nothing but a growth of a tissue or a tumor which actually does not resemble the tissue that is present there, or its adjacent tissue. That means anaplastic tissue is usually different from your adjacent tissue there. And this anaplasia can happen, it can indicate, or it is, a precursor for change of the cells, where then we can suspect a tumor growth or neoplastic growth in this anaplastic cells. And there's something called as teratomas. Teratomas are nothing but tumors of totipotent cells. As we all know, totipotent cells are the cells which has potential to develop into any three germ layer cells, that is ectodermal, mesodermal or endodermal. So when we're telling that this is a teratomatous tumor, then it should contain all cells that have been originated from all three different germ layers. Example for teratomas are, we have teratomatous dermoid, which is present in the ovaries, and we also have sacrococcygeal fetus or sacrococcygeal teratoma, which is nothing but fetus within a fetus. That means during the development, what happens, because of some totipotent cells that are present within the fetus, they develop or they germinate or they form into another fetal structure, where we can see fetal within a fetal, also called as sacrococcygeal teratoma. So these are various terminologies that comes when we are talking about neoplasms. So when we are going ahead of the tumors or neoplasm, there are two grossly classified tumors. One is your benign tumor and other one is malignant tumor. Benign tumors are, for example, we have ovarian tumors, we have ovarian fibroids, uterine fibroids, ovarian cysts, etc. Ovarian cyst adenomas, or we have this uterine fibroids, which are nothing but your benign tumors, which are usually localized growth, abnormal growth of cells, which are but they're localized and well encapsulated. We have malignancies like sarcomas and carcinomas, where we will see spreading cells which can deeply invade into the underlying structures and can also metastasize. So when we are classifying these benign tumors and malignant tumors, we have some differences between these two. So let me talk about those differences. First, age. You know, benign tumors can occur at any age, whereas malignant tumors usually occur in older age group, usually greater than 50 years, in the fourth and fifth decades of life. Normally, benign tumors are small, or they are smaller when compared to your malignant tumors, and when compared to the growth, they are usually slow and less, they're expansive but not infiltrative. Okay, they're not invasive, they're expansive. Whereas a malignant tumors, they're rapid in growth and they invade your adjacent structures. When we're talking about the spread of benign tumors, they are expansive. Sometimes what happens, they can invade the local tissues alone. Whereas malignant tumors are highly invasive. They invade your surrounding structures and they can also metastasize to local lymph nodes or distant organs also. And usually benign tumors are well encapsulated, and whereas malignant tumors are not usually encapsulated. And when you're talking about fixity, benign tumors are not fixed, whereas your malignant tumors, because of this invading nature and infiltrating nature, they are usually fixed. Cells are well differentiated and they resemble your adjacent tissues in case of benign tumors, whereas in malignant tumors, they are usually poorly differentiated and you find different kinds of cells within it, and hence it is called as pleomorphism. Okay, that phenomena is called as pleomorphism. And in benign tumors, very few or almost no mitotic figures can be seen. And in malignant tumors, we can see mitotic activity is profusely increased and we can see hypochromatic nuclei. As I told you earlier, we see many dysplastic features when you're talking about your malignant tumors. And in the surrounding structures, usually not involved. And because they are expansive, what happens is your surrounding structures can be displaced to a different space because of their expansion. However, they're usually not involved, they're not invaded. Whereas in malignant tumors, what happens is your adjacent or surrounding structures are usually involved. And in case of benign tumors, usually you will not find much of hemorrhage or ulcerations, unless they're secondarily infected or by, any other trauma, secondary trauma, etc. Whereas in malignant tumors, they are again of two types, they're proliferative and ulcerative, and usually they are, we see ulcers in them, and also sometimes we can see hemorrhage because of this, neoangiogenesis phenomena, where fresh or new capillaries are formed there, which are easily friable. They're refriable and they easily bruisable. They bleed on touch. Okay, that is again a pathognomic phenomena for your malignant tumors, and hence we can see this ulcerations and hemorrhages in case of malignancies. When we're talking about various types of malignant tumors, we have four different types of malignant tumors. One is carcinoma in situ. Carcinoma in situ is nothing but where there is a tumor, where there is an abnormal proliferation of cells, but it is being confined only to your epithelial layer. It has not gone into your deeper structures. That means there is no invasion into your deeper structures. However, there is a carcinoma in situ is usually potentially malignant, and this can turn into malignancy invading your underlying structures, invading the deep stroma, stromal tissue of or deeper layers of the tissue, resulting in invasive carcinomatous conditions. So carcinoma in situ is something that you have to take care, and proper treatment has to be instilled at that stage itself so that it will not progress into the real carcinoma. And then we have locally malignant tumor. In this locally malignant tumor, usually they do not metastasize. It is a malignancy, but these locally malignant tumors are usually, they occur within that particular region. If they are invasive also, they spread in that particular local area. However, they are not metastasizing. And coming to dormant cancer is something where, it remains dormant. It stays, for a longer time. Only by secondary instigation, like maybe a trauma or in the case of some pregnancy or some similar to these kind of, conditions, what happens, a dormant or underlying cancer, which was till then a slow growing one, rapidly grows. This dormant cancers, we can actually find them in our oral cavity also, especially if in the alveolar bone cancers. Usually these alveolar bone cancers, patient would not have found it for a longer period of time, but if a proper investigation was not performed and the tooth has been extracted, you can see this dormant cancer proliferating so rapidly within next few days of time. With the rapid growth of this can be seen coming out of the socket. So the patient will complain of non-healing socket and a growth from the socket if he or she has a dormant cancer within your alveolar bone. That means it is a slow growing one, usually not seen and until there was a secondary factor such as a trauma or some kind of extraction of tooth, etc. We have something, another type of malignant tumor called as latent cancer. This latent cancer is usually it is present within the body, but then it comes into picture in a later period of time. For example, prostatic cancer. This prostatic cancer is the one very good example of your latent cancer, because after 90 years of age, there is 100% incidence of prostatic cancer. Unless detected, it is not seen. For example, in 70 to 90 years of age group, 80% of prostatic cancers can be seen. How is can this can be diagnosed is, for example, if patient has in a retrograde study that has been done, if the prostate that has been taken from patients who have been who have died of various reasons, and when they checked, they found the symptoms or signs of your prostatic cancer. So latent cancer's good example is again your prostatic cancer. Now, after taking about different types of your malignant tumors, we have etiology of malignant tumors, how they are actually caused. There are various etiological factors for cancers, especially the tumors. The primary thing is lifestyle and habit history. Diet, lack of exercise can increase your free radicals within the body, which are carcinogenic. Then we also have various habits. Most common habit is cigarette smoking. Tobacco induced cancer is one of the most predominant and rapidly spreading types of cancer across the world. And in tobacco chewing, we see oral cancer, we see lung cancers, and in women, because of poor lifestyle, we see breast cancers that are more predominantly seen, and based on diet also, we see different types of cancers, it's most commonly GI cancers, okay? Coming to hydrocarbons, we have, hydrocarbons are some chemicals which are carcinogenic, and these hydrocarbons are usually found in tar. The tar material usually contains these hydrocarbons, which are again carcinogenic. We also see some other hydrocarbons like azodides. This azodides also are carcinogenic, and we have benzanthracene. Benzanthracene is again one form of hydrocarbon, which is also more predominantly causing cancers. And when we're talking about hydrocarbon induced cancers, lung cancer, skin cancers, especially because of this application or exposure to this more amount of hydrocarbons, are most commonly encountered malignancies when related to your hydrocarbons. Next, we have something called as radiation. As we all know, Hiroshima and Nagasaki, where atom bombs were tested during World War II, because of this excessive radiation, till now people who were present there and are living presently also have this genetical mutation leading to leukemias. Most predominantly, leukemias are seen in these areas of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. We have Hodgkin's lymphoma also. You know, Hodgkin's lymphoma is also very much related to radiation. Basal cell carcinoma. This is because of direct exposure to UVA and UVB. That is your nothing but your ultraviolet radiation. Excessive ultraviolet radiation onto the face, especially your middle third of the face, most commonly involved in basal cell carcinomas, is also because of radiation. Osteogenic sarcomas. You know, whenever we have any benign bony lesion, that is the reason radiotherapy is contraindicated in the benign bony lesions. Because, for example, in fibrous dysplasia or these kind of pages, what happens is when we are putting radiation to these structures, it can have a malignant transformation leading to osteogenic sarcomas. So radiation is again one of the most important contributing factor for cancers. Next, we have oncogenic viruses. Recently, we have seen many viruses that are related to cancers. Most common one is HTLV virus, that is nothing but human T lymphocytic, T lymphocytic virus. And we have Epstein-Barr virus. Epstein-Barr virus also like nasopharyngeal carcinomas, etc. Even HIV virus is been most commonly seen with Kaposi's sarcoma. You know, these oncogenic viruses, what they do is they modify the gene system. You know, genetic, they lead to genetic mutations leading to these malignancies again. And we have some other co-carcinogens. Co-carcinogens like heredity. Hereditary is a factor where few of the cancers are carried through families. We have chronic irritation. Chronic irritation, one of the beautiful example is Kangri cancer. Kangri cancer is nothing but most commonly seen in Kashmiris, where they actually put a hot pot. They actually keep it near the stomach to get rid of the cool temperatures there, to increase the warmthness. What they do is they take this cold filled pots near, and they keep near the stomach. This leads to stomach cancer in them. This is because of chronic thermal irritation, nothing but Kangri's cancer. And then we have trauma. Osteosarcoma induced because of trauma is one good example. And recently also in oral cavity, because of sharp cusps only, it has been proved that these sharp cusps leading to chronic irritation, especially on the buccal mucosa or the tongue, can lead to squamous cell carcinomas there again. This is because of long-term chronic irritation because of trauma. Diet, where you have malnutrition, or sometimes what happens is antioxidant-rich diet usually is useful to combat cancers. When you're not taking antioxidant-rich diet, this can lead to cancers again. Geography, based on the place also, this can be because of their lifestyle, because of their diet, because of the climate, because of actinic radiation. So there are so many factors when we're talking about geography related tumors. Most commonly we see Burkitt's lymphoma most commonly seen in South African countries. Carcinoma of stomach, usually seen in Japan, maybe because of the diet. These are some of the malignant tumors that are usually associated with food conditions or lifestyle conditions, or geography also. Next, when we are talking about the spread of these malignant tumors, how malignant tumors spread to different, we have seen that malignant tumors are usually, they can metastasize and they can involve more than one organ. So the spread of malignant tumors is by various mechanisms. The first one is local or direct spread. When you're talking about this local or direct spread, usually they're invasive, and it is because of direct infiltration of the tumor cells. How do they directly infiltrate? It is because the tumor cells, especially in the malignancies, what happens is, maybe because of deficiency of calcium, the cell adhesiveness has been decreased. The adhesiveness of the cells is lost, and hence what happens, the cells are usually free. Because of this freeness, they can get infiltrated in different areas surrounding, leading to local infiltration and thus again invasion of the surrounding structures. Next one is, these tumor cells are known to produce an enzyme called hyaluronidase. Hyaluronidase, as we all know, it has a capacity to break the ground substance and thus allows these cells to infiltrate into your adjacent surrounding tissues. Next, these tumor cells, when we're talking about local or direct spread, they pass through line of least resistance. Okay, sign of least resistance can be anything like tissue spaces or anatomical spaces that we have, and these cells can spread to the adjacent tissues, again leading to your spread of malignant tumors. That is the reason when you're talking about line of resistance, least resistance in cartilage and also deep dense facial sheets will be there, no? In those areas what happens is usually the tumor cells cannot penetrate because they are less infiltrative, both cartilage and dense facial sheets, hence they are usually confined. Your malignant tumors are confined and when they come to these structures. Next one is invasion through lymphatics, that is nothing but lymphogenous spread. And this lymphogenous spread usually seen most commonly carcinomas are the one that spread through these lymphatics. And this spread through lymphatics is usually by two modalities. One is through permeation and one is through embolism. However, embolic spread is the primary mode of spread in case of lymphogenous spread. And permeation is nothing but what happens is when we actually have a lumen, there will be growth of the cells, your tumor cells along the line, along the column, in the columnar growth of the lumen. So when they're columnarly growing, what happens? They spread along this lumen into another place. This is what happens is sometimes there can be central necrosis into the lumen, and also the initial stage where it has started can undergo necrosis, and the advancing end can spread to whichever distance it wants. Okay, this is nothing but permeation. Permeation is usually seen in breast cancer, where the skin of the of the breast usually gives a putty orange or orange peel appearance, especially if it is spreading through permeation. And we also have something called as cancer encrotase. It is nothing but skin of your chest wall is also because of permeation gives you this appearance. As I already said, through embolism, primary route is embolism. Here, what this can be explained. Well, in case of distant nodal metastasis, usually when we have this nodal metastasis, the line which is through which it is spreading may not be involved. For example, we have breast cancer and it has an axial spread, but the route in which it is actually spreading will not be involved. This is because what happens, the tumor cells that are proliferating at one particular area, they become they separate from there and they travel along the route. And they get embolized. And that embolus, what happens? It goes and sits in a place like a distant nodal structure, and there it again grows and infiltrates. This is nothing but embolization. For example, we have Virchow's nodes. Okay, Virchow's nodes are nothing but supraclavicular nodes. These nodes are usually involved, especially when they have retrograde embolism. That is, in the GI cancer, what happens? Your left supraclavicular node is involved, nothing but trochlear side. It is because of retrograde embolism. That is, these tumor cells are being infiltrated into a distant node. No, that is nothing but your supraclavicular nodes. Okay, this is about embolism. And we have something called as transcelomic spread. Transcelomic spread is again usually not very much seen, but it is usually seen in visceral areas, viscous structures. It's here the tumor cells usually spread through serous cavities of viscous. Okay, that is nothing but transcelomic spread. And we have a hematogenous spread, again a very important mode of spread, usually seen in sarcomatous spread. And this we have various venal structures where this hematogenous spread occurs. One is systemic veins, most commonly seen, pulmonary veins, and portal system of veins, usually in case of GI cancers or stomach cancers. Vertebral system through veins of Batson, usually your spinal canal, the spinal canal spreads through these veins of Batson the sarcomas or your neoplasms of your malignancies of the spinal canal usually spread through vertebral system of veins of Batson. This is about hematogenous spread. And in this hematogenous spread, nothing is there. What happens is there are tumor cells are present. These tumor cells usually enter into the capillary or arterial system. And from the site of, your tumor presence, from there the cells are usually taken through this blood vessels and they are lodged at different areas where they again give rise to a metastatic lesion there. And through natural passages also we can see this. It is nothing but epithelial lined passages. Usually in case of bronchus and uterus, we see this spread of tumor cells again, and inoculation. Inoculation is nothing but through direct contact. Example, in case of if there is a tumor, and by by using a scalpel or blade, we're directly inoculating the cells from one place to another cell. When you're doing a suture, you are taking a the tumor cells and seeding it to another site. Other site, it is nothing but through inoculation. But this is one of the rarely seen spread of malignant tumors. Your direct invasion or local invasion, hematogenous spread, and lymphatic spread are usually the most common types of spreading of your malignant tumors. So this is about a brief introduction of how benign tumors and malignant tumors occur, and the mode of spread of your malignant tumors, and the causative etiological factors also we have seen. Next, we'll go into benign tumors of skin, normally soft tissue benign tumors of the skin. So now we will be talking about various benign tumors, benign soft tissue tumors of the skin. And the first or most common one is papilloma. Papilloma is usually a benign tumor of your epidermal layer. It can be either sessile or pedunculated. Okay, this contains usually the epithelial cells, and this can occur anywhere, like on the skin or even on the mucous membrane. However, the skin or cutaneous papillomas are one of the most common ones. When we are talking about the ones in the mucous membrane, we have squamous cell papillomas, transitional cell papillomas, and columnar cells. Squamous cell papillomas usually seen on the oral mucosa, the buccal mucosal layers, and on the tongue. And transitional cell papillomas are usually seen in the uterus, most commonly seen in the uterus structures, and columnar cells are usually seen in the GI tract. And the ductal wall papillomas usually seen in the breast, and cyst wall papillomas are usually seen in the ovaries and sometimes also in the breast. When coming to this cutaneous papillomas, which are again, I said, they are the commonest one, and this cutaneous papillomas are of two types. One is squamous cell papilloma and basal cell papilloma. In squamous cell papilloma, we have again four different varieties. One is congenital papilloma. As the name itself indicates, it is usually present from the time of the birth, and as age grows, this can also show its growth in structure. This can also grow. And coming to infective papilloma, also called as infective warts, or it is also called as verruca vulgaris. Okay, infective papillomas are also called as verruca vulgaris. It is usually because of virus. That is the reason it is called as infective papilloma. Because of this viral induced infective papillomas, what happens is they can be either solitary wart or multiple warts. And these multiple warts usually can occur on the palms, on fingers, and also on the sole. If it occurs on the sole, it is also called as plantar warts. And in children and adolescents, it is usually more common. And these infective papillomas can disappear spontaneously sometimes. And when they disappear, what happens? They leave a nice pale pink colored skin there. Okay, this is about infective papillomas. They have soft papillomas usually seen in elderly, especially at the corner of your eyelids. Okay, here we can see soft papillomas in elderly patient, and also keratin warts also seen in elderly or older patients. And this keratin warts are usually caused because of excess keratin production. Next one is basal cell papillomas. This basal cell papilloma, also called as seborrheic keratitis or senile warts, or these are also called as senile warts, usually associated in middle age or old age patients. Okay, this basal cell papillomas are usually seen in middle age or old age patients. And what happens is, when this basal cell papilloma occurs, they usually fall off. They need not be taken off. They usually fall off, usually occurs on the trunk and again on your armpits and on the arms. This basal cell papilloma is usually a slow growing type of papillomas, usually seen in middle age or older age group. When we are talking about the management, as I said, most of the papillomas, especially your basal cell papillomas and some of the infective papillomas, they disappear by themselves. However, some of these warts, what happens, or papillomas in a common name is wart, this occurs on the facial structures and also on the neck most commonly. When they pose an aesthetic discomfort to the patient, then they have to be excised. Talking about plantar warts, what happens in this condition, there can be a little painful and also discomfort to the patient. In those conditions, the management could be formaldehyde application, especially during the night time, silver nitrate application, and curettage or excision has to be done. So this is about your papillomas. And next common tumor is adenoma. Adenoma is nothing but a benign tumor of your glandular tissue. It can occur in any glandular tissue, either an endocrine or an exocrine. However, an endocrine adenoma does not contain acini, but your exocrine adenomas usually contain acinar cells. And these adenomas are usually well encapsulated and they occur in any glandular tissue, not just salivary glands. They can occur in breast, they can occur in prostate, etc. And normally these adenomas, what happens is they sometimes, you know, in the exocrine especially, when they grow from the mucous membrane, they have a small peduncle to it, and hence this appearance of this tumor with this peduncle is called as polypus. These polypus can occur in the colon also, and they can be multiple in number, and that is called as polyposis coli. Okay, and these adenomas are of two types, you know, grossly classified into two types. One is fibroadenoma and cyst adenoma or papillary cyst adenoma. In fibroadenoma, again, there are of two types. Fibroadenoma is usually seen in the breast where a connective, specialized connective tissue is present. And this fibroadenoma is of two types, that is pericanalicular adenoma and intracanalicular adenoma. Pericanalicular adenoma is usually hard in consistency, whereas intracanalicular adenoma is soft in consistency. In pericanalicular adenoma, why is it hard? Because it is surrounded by your dense connective tissue, whereas in intracanalicular adenoma, it has this soft or loose connective tissue. Normally, this loose connective tissue of intracanalicular adenoma, what happens? It impinges into the ducts, elongated, and this, because of this impingement into the duct and growth, you know, along your ductal growth, it is usually elongated and has a slit-like nature. Okay, it appears a slit-like appearance. We have something called as Brody's tumor. Brody's tumor is nothing but a giant fibroadenoma, usually arising from a mucous membrane or soft tissue, where it has a rapid growth and also it you know, enlarges into a bigger size. That is nothing but Brody's tumor. And we have cyst adenoma or papillary cyst adenoma. In this, what happens, within the adenoma there will be cystic growth. There will be cystic spaces in which papillary ingrowth of neoplastic tissue can occur, and these are of two types. One is serous cyst adenoma and pseudomucinous cyst adenoma. This is based upon the secretions they do. That is, in serous cyst adenoma, usually the secretions are serous in nature. This is about adenomas. Now we'll go into fibromas. Fibroma are again one of the most common commonly encountered benign tumors. These fibromas can occur anywhere where there is fibrous connective tissue. Usually they can be firm or hard in consistency or softer. These fibromas in the initial stages are usually softer in consistency, and as they mature, they turn into firm in consistency. These fibromas again are they can either be sessile or pedunculated, well encapsulated, or they can be rounded, actually round to ovoid in shape, and they are well differentiated. They are they're not diffuse. Okay, they can be nicely demarcated, well demarcated fibromas. They're usually combined with other mesodermal tissues, and when they're combined with them based upon the tissue, for example, fibrolipoma, we have fibrous connective tissue along with lipid, that is your fat cells. In fibromyoma, along with fibrous tissue, we have muscle cells associated with it. And in neurofibroma, some of the neural cells or neural cells are again present, which is called as neurofibroma. Myxofibroma, fibroma with myxomatous material is called as myxofibroma. Desmoid tumor is present. We also have myxoma associated with it. In this picture, we can see a fibroma of left buccal mucosa. Usually, these fibromas arise. The etiological factors could be mostly irritation or trauma. If it is because of trauma, they're called as traumatic fibromas. And because of an irritation, it is called as irritational fibroma. This irritation can be normal gingival calculus also, which can lead to gingival fibroma. And because of any trauma to the mucosa, it can lead to traumatic fibroma. Usually the skin over them is pale in color, or if because of trauma, there is a constant or chronic trauma there, you can see hyperkeratinization, and it is well demarcated and usually painless. Unless secondarily infected, they are usually painless. They do not ulcerate more commonly consistency, as we thought, it is soft on to firm in consistency. The treatment for it, you know, when we come to management, usually excision, if it is bothering a patient, then we do a excision for this fibromas. Next, coming to myoma. Myoma is again a benign tumor of your muscle cells, muscle structure. And based upon the type of muscle, that is whether it is a skeletal muscle or smooth muscle, they are divided into rhabdomyoma and leiomyoma. Rhabdomyoma is usually a benign tumor of your skeletal muscle. However, it is rarely seen. Leiomyoma of smooth muscle tumors is usually more commonly encountered. This rhabdomyoma in children, sometimes what can happen is it can convert into or transform into rhabdomyosarcoma, which is a malignant condition, and it is a dreadful condition, again fatal, and hence all rhabdomyomas are to be taken, you know, with more caution. Okay, and leiomyoma actually seen in soft tissue, I mean smooth muscle, more commonly seen in case of your GI tract, we can see, and also in the smooth muscle structures, you can see leiomyomas. Whereas rhabdomyoma in skeletal muscles, most intraoral lesions is tongue, you can see this rhabdomyomas. If this myoma is associated with other mesodermal tissues, then like you know, fibroleiomyoma, the fibroids can be seen. Okay, management of this is excision. We have to do a skin excision and remove it completely, or diathermy can also be used when we are treating this myomas. Next is lipoma. Lipoma is known to be a universal tumor or ubiquitous tumor. It is usually tumor of your fat cells, and these tumors are present anywhere. It can be present under the skin, it can be present within the mucosal membrane. You know, they are ubiquitous, they're present anywhere. And usually there are three different types of your lipomas. We have encapsulated one, which is the most common one. We have diffuse or pseudolipoma, where diffusely we can see it around along the body. We have multiple lipomas or lipomatosis, it is called as lipomatosis, where we can see multiple lipomas present, you know, in the neck. We can see nape of the neck, on the arm, on the, you know, within the oral cavity, like this we can see multiple lipomas. And we have Durkheim's disease or adiposis dolorosa. We have neurolipomatosis, where there is association with your neural cells, and fibrolipoma, as the name itself indicates, there is fibrous tissue associated with lipoma. Nevolipoma, we see some of the melanoma, we have this melanocytes within it, like nevus, associated with the lipoma. We have neurolipoma, where you see neural tissues, you know, neural tissue along with the lipomatous structure there. Coming to complications of this lipoma, they can undergo myxomatous degeneration, saponification, sometimes calcification. Very rarely, they can undergo malignant transformation or sarcomatous transformation. When we are talking about their anatomical structures, based on the anatomical structures, then again, these lipomas are again divided into subcutaneous type, usually the name itself indicates, usually present underneath the skin, subfacial type, under the fascia, the intermuscular lipoma or intramuscular lipoma, within the muscular areas. Usually in this intermuscular lipoma, it loses its characteristics. I mean, it is not the character of that lipoma, where it's like slip sign, soft inconsistency, palpableness is usually lost in case of this intermuscular lipomas, intramuscular, because they're present deep here, okay, deep into the muscle, hence they cannot be palpated properly. And we have subserous lipoma, we have submucous lipoma, intraarticular lipomas usually present within the bony joints, you know, in the joint structures we can see, subsynovial lipomas, periosteal lipomas, extraglandular and intraglandular lipomas can be seen. That's the reason, because it is present in so many structures, it is called as ubiquitous tumor, ubiquitous benign tumor. Encapsulated lipoma, which is the most common one, it is usually present subcutaneously. Here what happens is, we can see dimpling of the skin is one of the characteristic feature, occurs usually at any age, but older age group is most commonly seen. And the site of this encapsulated lipoma can be seen in the arm region, in the neck region, even on the face, and also in the mucosal structures. Here a characteristic slip sign positive is seen, because when we take the lipoma between your fingers and when we press it, it usually slips from the finger. It is called as slip sign. These lipomas have slip sign positive. Even transillumination is also positive in case of lipomas. Coming to management, if they are not posing any problem, usually we can leave them. But if they are aesthetically bothering, then we'll go with excision. And in this excision, what we can do is, excision is made along the Langer's line of superficial skin until your capsule of lipoma is felt, and then it is sideward dissection is done, and we elevate your the superficial skin, and complete enucleation of lipoma is done. That is the management of lipoma. Next one is hemangioma. Hemangioma is again your benign tumor of hematogenous structures, that is your blood vessels. It is usually a hematoma. Okay, hemangioma is a kind of hematoma, and we have three different types of hemangiomas. One is based upon the type of blood vessel it is involving, like capillary hemangioma, venous hemangioma, or arterial or plexiform hemangioma. Capillary hemangioma is again one of the most common one. In this, we have three different types again. One is strawberry angioma, which has a strawberry nevus. We have port wine stain and also Salmon's patch. Strawberry angioma or strawberry nevus is nothing but it is a localized one. Usually, it is seen as a proliferative growth and very small. Pulsations will not be seen here. I mean, will not be palpable. Usually, it does not bleed not much of bleeding can be seen in case of this hemangioma or strawberry hemangioma. It is a solitary growth. It can be a solitary sessile growth in case of strawberry hemangioma. We have something called strawberry hemangiomas are most commonly seen in younger children. The most common location is face and also on the skull and also back of the body. Next, we have port vein stain. Port vein stain is nothing but you have a deep red color stain. Okay, it is again. Here also it is superficial in nature, and face is again one of the common site for port vein and also palms, hands can be seen, and also on the arms. And this port vein stain usually does not have any pulsations, and here when we apply pressure, what happens is blood, we can see blanching, and when we remove it again, it comes into the particular place, that is that dioscopy positive. Dioscopy test is usually positive in case of this hemangiomas. We have another form of capillary hemangioma is Salmon's patch. In strawberry hemangioma, a red mark is present after 1 to 3 weeks of birth, usually compressible swelling. All this strawberry hemangioma usually involutes within first 2 years, or sometimes within 7 years of age it involutes. That means it decreases by itself. Usually they're soft, compressible, and they're not pulsatile. Dioscopy is positive. In port vein stain, as I already discussed, it is present since birth, and the color may alter here. Usually it can be deep purple red, or sometimes it can move into light brownish in color as age increases. When you're talking about port vein stain, it is usually present since birth, and here the normal color is about deep purple-ish in color, deep purple red in color. As age progresses, it usually converts into brown color. The common locations are face, shoulder, neck, and buttock, and usually this port vein stain is again diffuse. Dioscopy test is positive. No pulsations are felt in this. Usually, port vein stain is associated with Sturge-Weber syndrome. Okay, in this Sturge-Weber syndrome, usually a facial port vein stain can be seen, especially with hemangiomas, hemangioma of ipsilateral cerebral hemisphere can occur. This can lead to Jacksonian epilepsy also. Salmon's patch is usually again seen since birth. It also involutes as age process. Forehead, occiput, midline of the body are common sites of them. How do you manage? As we said, most of them are involute. So wait and watch till about 7 years of age, and if it is still persisting, then we'll go with excision with skin grafting. If it is localized hemangioma, like in strawberry hemangioma, if it is present only in a particular area, we can go ahead with sclerotherapy. Sclerotherapy uses injection of sclerosing agents like sodium orate, or you can go with the tetradecyl sulfate. These sclerosing agents are glycerin or hot water. We can also go with saline. When we are injecting the sclerosing agents there, what happens is bleomycin is also one of the sclerosing agents. When we actually inject this will cause sclerosing of the hemangioma, and it will lead to healing. So sclerotherapy is one of the management technique, and we have cryotherapy also for excision of hemangioma. Steroid injections can also be given directly intralesionally within the hemangioma. This can also be helpful in treating these hemangiomas. Finally, X-ray therapy, however, it is not commonly used in case of hemangiomas. X-ray therapy can also be given. Coming to cavernous hemangiomas, cavernous hemangioma is again consists of, you know, multiple dilated venous channels there. Usually this cavernous hemangioma does not involute. It is always raised, I mean it is bigger in size, localized swelling is present, pulsations are rarely seen, okay. It is usually non-pulsatile, again cavernous hemangioma. However, it is compressible. When we press it is compressible. The ascope is also positive in case of your cavernous hemangiomas. When we treat it, sclerotherapy, 3% sodium orotate can be given, cautery can be done, or finally surgery, you know, you have to remove it along its capsule, it can be removed by ligating the arteries, you know, or if it is involving ligating the blood vessels, that is involving on the both sides. And arterial or plexiform hemangioma is again congenital arteriovenous fistula, where your abnormal connection between artery and venous occurs. It is usually pulsatile. If it is occurring in the tooth, within the bone, what happens? We can see pumping tooth syndrome, where because of the hemangioma, what happens? The teeth are pushed above the occlusal levels, and if we press them and relieve, again they come back to its, you know, because of the pulsations underneath, they come back into its original state which they are present. Okay, pumping tooth syndrome is one of the condition. We have something called as crizoid aneurysm, usually seen in case of forehead or skull, in case of this arterial hemangiomas. How did we manage them? In arteriovenous fistulas, usually we have a feeding artery from somewhere. So that has to be ligated, and it has to be, embolization has to be done, and then excision of this hemangiomas are usually done. We have spider nevus. Spider nevus is again a single dilated feeding arteriole, most commonly seen in the trunk region on the face and arms. Why it is called as spider nevus? Because from the center, what happens? We can see many radiating lines appearing like a spider web. Okay, it is called as spider nevus, or spider fingers will be there. No, it's legs. Okay, it appears like that, and usually seen in case of hepatic cirrhosis or hepatic tumors, and also tumors which are producing estrogen. In those cases, we can see this spider nevus. Okay. Then the next one is glomus tumor. Usually in this glomus tumor, what happens is that surrounding this arteriovenous anastomosis, we have large pale cells. These cells are called as glomus cells. As a tumor contains these glomus cells, it is called as glomus tumor, also called as glomangioma. Usually this glomangioma is painful, and on seeing it appears reddish blue in color, usually less than 1 cm, softer in consistency. In usually most commonly seen in age group of 5th decade, okay. Glomus tumors can be seen in the intestine, the gut, esophageal region, in the ear also. Glomus tumor is one of the common condition. How they actually appear? I forgot to tell. Even this glomus tumor, you know, they are usually seen in the nail bed region. Okay, one of the common site for this glomus tumor is nail bed region. Hence, when you're talking about differential diagnosis, they appear as subungual melanomas or granulomas. Hence, they also have to be treated, because subungual melanoma is again a malignant disorder which has to be treated promptly. Okay, and it appears like squamous papilloma or granuloma pyogenicum. Management is again excision of this tumor. Next one is lymphangioma. Lymphangioma is again a congenital variety. We can see multiple small, you know, granular like lesions in case of lymphangioma. It is a benign tumor of lymphatics. Usually it is of two types. One is superficial and deep. Superficial lesions, most commonly common locations are again tongue. In the tongue, lymphangioma appears like a toadstool appearance. You know, you have a toad egg appearance, multiple eggs of a toad, you know. Similarly, we see multiple projections on the tongue of this lymphatics, and it is called as lymphangioma of tongue. We also have something called as lymphangioma circumscriptum, usually a superficial lesion, and sites of it, all lymphatic areas, wherever, very rich in areas, you know, we can see like in tongue, we can see in the neck region, etc. Normally, these lymphangiomas are softer in consistency and they are translucent, and they appear to have water within them. Hence, the color they appear is yellow or watery in color. Fluctuant it is. Fluid thrill is usually present. Cystic hygroma, you know, if these lymphangiomas grow in a larger size, we can call them as cystic hygroma. These cystic hygromas are usually softer in consistency. Transillumination is positive in them. They can grow into very large lesions, okay? disfiguring lesions also, and management is again surgical excision. Now coming to neuromas, neuroma is again a benign tumor of your nerve tissue. And there are two types of neuromas. One is true neuromas and false neuromas. True neuromas are nothing but neuroblastoma, ganglioneuroma. We have pheochromocytoma, which has chromaffin tissue within it. And false neuromas includes neural emoma and neurofibromas. Okay. When you are talking about neural emoma, it's nothing but a false neuroma. It is usually ectodermal in origin. Schwannoma. These neural emomas, if they are ectodermal in origin, it is called as neural emoma. If they are from neural crest cells, it is called a schwannoma, and neurofibroma arising from perineurium or endoneurium. Normally, these are benign tumors. They are well encapsulated. Schwannomas are circumscribed. Usually, Schwann cells, you know, we have the Schwann cells. It is benign tumor of these cells, and usually it is white or gray in color and firm. Most commonly, it involves acoustic nerve, and management is again excision of the tumor. In neurofibroma, usually it is developmental in origin. It is a type of hematomatous growth again. These neurofibromas can be the solitary neurofibromas or diffuse neurofibromas. If there are solitary neurofibromas, they occur at any different locations, usually on the face, neck again, on the trunk, arms, etc. These neurofibromas, which are solitary, usually they are firm in consistency, they are well demarcated, localized, and they are a sessile growth, or usually this growth are about a few millimeters to centimeters, and the surface is usually smooth, firm swellings, and they can lead to paresthesia of the involved nerve. Acoustic neuroma is one of the most common type of local or solitary neurofibroma. We have ulnar and median nerve involvement also. Complications of these solitary neuromas are usually cystic degeneration, and they can also undergo malignant transformation into sarcomas. Management of them is again excision. However, they have high recurrence rate, hence a positive resection margin has to be taken to prevent this recurrence, and also patient has to be recalled or periodical checkup has to be done to prevent this recurrence. Next one, we have generalized neurofibromatosis. In this condition, we have this neurofibromas present all over the body, most commonly trunk, neck, face, okay, highly disfiguring. Also called as this generalized neurofibromatosis is also called as von Recklinghausen's disease of nerve. One should not get confused with von Recklinghausen's disease of bone. Both are different, okay? Generalized neurofibromatosis is nothing but von Recklinghausen's disease of nerve. Usually, there are the sites are usually spinal, cranial, and peripheral nerves. It is again an autosomal dominant inherited disorder. Multiple nodules are seen here. We have a characteristic cephalot spots. You know, it is coffee-colored spots which can be seen. Diffused coffee-colored spots can be seen in case of this neurofibromatosis, where circumscribed spots can be seen. It is usually associated with skeletal abnormalities also, and about 5% of these generalized neurofibromatosis can undergo malignant transformation. A management of it, usually they are painless, and sometimes rarely can cause paresthesia. They are firm in consistency. Multiple nodular growths can be seen all over the skin, usually ear, acoustic nerve region, on the face, on the facial nerve region, on the neck, back of the trunk, on the trunk region, and back of the neck are most, back of your body are most common areas. If it is solitary, you have to do excision. You can do excision, but if they are multiple, better leave it. Do not excise multiple and diffuse unless it is aesthetically problematic to the patient. Need not be excised. Okay. We have something called as plexiform neurofibromatosis. In this plexiform neurofibromatosis, pachydermatocele also. It is usually a rare condition. This plexiform neurofibromatosis is usually seen in subcutaneous fat, and most commonly seen in trigeminal nerve region. Normally, this plexiform neurofibromatosis, the swelling is present, and this swelling, with the swelling, what happens? We have a thickened overlying skin of the swelling, and these are aesthetically unpleasing, usually firm in consistency, painless also. And when you're talking about elephantiasis neurofibromatosis, this elephantiasis neurofibromatosis is nothing but severe form of your plexiform neurofibromatosis. Most commonly, leg and thighs are involved. Rare condition, most congenital in nature. What happens is the subcutaneous tissue is usually thickened there, and the fibrous tissue replaces fat. Legs are usually very much enlarged, and they actually resemble that of elephant's leg, and hence the name elephantiasis neurofibromatosis. Next is cutaneous neurofibromatosis. It is also called as molluscum fibrosum. Usually they are multiple in number, small, firm and discrete. Acoustic neuroma is a commonest sequelae of it. We have dumbbell shaped neuroma in case of this cutaneous neurofibromatosis. We also see stump or amputation neuroma, where after an amputation or after a surgical excision, we can see this neuromas developing, nothing but stump or amputation neuroma. This is a case of multiple neurofibromatosis, cutaneous neurofibromatosis seen here. Management, whenever we are amputating a nerve, we have to take a care because it can lead to amputating neuromas, and hence amputation of nerve has to be done with care. And excision of neuromas, if it is usually localized one, we can nicely excise the neuroma. But again, if it is diffuse one, wait and watch, unless patient is having any discomfort with it, either in terms of pain or in terms of, usually they are painless, they doesn't cause any pain. However, if the patient is having any discomfort with it, you can wait and watch if they are multiple in number. So this is about neuromas. So we have discussed different types of benign soft tissue tumors, and this gives you a brief intro or brief idea about various soft tissue, benign soft tissue tumors of the skin. Okay, thank you. And in the next class, we'll be dealing about various malignant tumors of the skin. Thank you.